creating effective dashboards is how we get security done. You notice whether compliance is a more important area than hacking assurance, and it could go back and forth. Most security KPIs are meaningless. We want to have a balanced set of KPIs. Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we look at the best practices in cybersecurity. This week we look at reporting. Sounds boring, but it's super important. Creating effective dashboards is how we get security done. Because in the end, it's not the security people that need to take actions to keep companies and organizations secure. It's IT operations, it's the business teams, it really is everyone not clicking on phishing emails and whatnot. So we need to be effective ambassadors around the cause that is cybersecurity, and we need to spread it widely. And to inform other people about what they need to do, we need effective dashboards. In my experience, we need dashboards on three different levels of abstraction for three different purposes. First is project tracking, basically a readiness dashboard around whatever the project tries to achieve, creating a new piece of software, a new business line, whatever it might be. You as a security team want to embed yourself in that project and be part of the dashboard to show them whether or not they're ready for launch. Second, KPI tracking. We need them to inform others, IT ops, for instance, about whether or not they're within their security requirements. Third, benchmarking. We compare ourselves to others to see where we're doing great, but also to identify areas where we are below average and can quickly learn from others. Between those three, the project readiness tracks the change, the KPIs track the run, and the benchmarking tracks our ambitions on what we should be aiming for. We'll go into the first two a little bit more today, and then we'll have a separate video on benchmarking, because that's a topic really worth exploring with a bit more breadth. Let's first go into the project tracking, the readiness dashboard. Here we track multiple things clustered in two areas, hacking assurance and compliance. In hacking assurance, we ask whether a technical system is assured to a best practice standard in its architecture, configuration, and implementation. And these are, of course, building on one another. If you have flaws in the architecture, it doesn't matter how well you configure or implement a system, those can never be fixed. Equally, if you have big configuration gaps in your infrastructure, it doesn't matter how well you implement the application. So you first assure the architecture, then assure the configuration, and then the implementation. And the dashboard, as I'm using it, tracks the number of findings and specifically flags the most severe finding. So if you have some medium architecture findings, but a severe configuration issue, that's the focal point of attention. The worst possible status, though, in my dashboards is not knowing anything about an area. So if you don't know whether there's critical issues, so you start your dashboard not knowing anything around architecture, configuration, or implementation, and you're filling these areas with tests. So even if you find critical issues, that's better than not knowing anything about it. And from there, of course, you can see how the issues get resolved, until you finally reach a point where you have looked at architecture, configuration, and implementation, and concluded that no critical or high severity findings persist. The second cluster when tracking project security readiness is around compliance. That's your internal compliance, but sometimes also regulatory or governmental compliance that you have to adhere to. So whichever it might be, you start with a self-assessment. You give people a chance to first state whether or not they're compliant. It's not your responsibility as the security team to reach that compliance. It's not even really your responsibility to attest to that compliance. So you give people a chance to do that themselves through self-assessment. And then just to check the homework, you're adding an audit later. So again, you're tracking with the colors. Haven't been tested, that's the worst. Critical findings, high findings, medium, low, and so forth. And as you're going through this traffic light system, you notice whether compliance is a more important area than hacking assurance. And it could go back and forth. Wherever your hotspot currently is where your attention is needed to make sure that there are flow down charts to read the readiness on the date that you want to launch a new system. Next, we look at security KPIs. your way of tracking whether the operations are keeping your system secure. Most security KPIs that I've seen are meaningless. Bad examples include the number of firewall alerts, basically how many packets from the internet were refused to enter your network. That's just a weather report of the internet. Sometimes it's a lot, sometimes it's a little, has nothing to do with your company. An equally bad example, number of missing patches. Now this requires a little bit more intelligence about your company, at least you're doing some scanning, but the number of missing patches, what really does that mean about your security? There are some patches that are much, much more severe than others, and just to summing up the number doesn't give you any intelligence, but rather creates this sense of frustration that you'll never be able to see the light at the end of the tunnel. When thinking through security KPIs, we want to have a balanced set of KPIs where none of these invites to be gamed, so to nominally achieve the KPI, but not having to create additional security. And one way to game, for instance, the number of missing patches KPI is to block your security scanner at the firewall. So that cannot possibly be your way of creating more security by hiding the results. So in my experience, three factors need to be balanced when choosing KPIs. First, scope. Are the highest risk prioritized in your KPI? If the highest risks are not prioritized by your KPI, then it's not a risk mitigation measure. Second, timeliness. Are deviations from the KPI resolved in a timely manner? Obviously, that's important, but you can see how there's already a tug of war now. With the scope, you want it to be as large as possible to include everything important, but the timeliness requires you to be focused. So here's already a trade-off decision. Creating yet more trade-off choices is the third KPI criteria, and that is effectiveness. Are you able to improve the KPI by using only a reasonable amount of company resources? And again, this is in a trade-off with the other two. You want everything to be very broad in scope, very quick in resolution, but using only few resources. Before, we looked at the negative example of counting the number of patches as a KPI in vulnerability management. So what is a better set of KPIs now in vulnerability management to guide the organization towards better outcomes? In this case, we would set three KPIs that balance each other out. The first is you set the hacking impact of vulnerabilities, and you can use different methodologies. There's a whole industry now around vulnerability prioritization, but the idea is that rather than counting vulnerabilities, you ask, which vulnerability does the hacker really not want you to fix? Because that's the entrance door. And what's the next one and the next one? And you're quickly running out of options because most patches are not actually necessary. So how do you start on condensing your vulnerabilities into a highly prioritized list where only a few or maybe a few dozens are actually highly hackable? Either you implement a tool that already does that for you, and most vulnerability management tools these days do something around exploitability, for instance, or you ask your red team if you have one. They know what vulnerabilities they like and which ones are harder to exploit. Or you just follow a public list like the CEF list, for instance, the commonly exploited vulnerabilities. If you fix everything on that list, you're already better than average. So that's your first KPI, something around hackability. Your second KPI is how long people need to implement patches. So if this takes a long time, then of course you're not timely. You have the right scope, but the outcomes are still not the right ones. As the third KPI, to balance that out again, you look at the number of escalations. Basically, how often did you have to sign a risk acceptance because people can't patch in the time that you require from them? And between those three, hackability, patch timing, and number of escalations or risk acceptances, you have a well-balanced set of KPIs in that area. Much better than just counting patches or vulnerabilities. There are plenty of other areas where you need security KPIs, but this set, the vulnerability management, is already a main one. And the other main one is security monitoring. So if you implement security KPIs in these two areas, you're nearly there in guiding your IT operations. If you're curious about implementing KPIs in other areas, help me help you and comment below what areas you're curious about. If you find these discussions helpful, please show it with a like and subscribe. And until next week, happy hacking.